was our room here, our seminar room, quite beautiful. And just here, behind our room, you see the river Neisse, which is separating Germany from Poland. Quite beautiful.
Yes, so thank you very much for coming. I thought that we start as follows. We want to introduce ourselves for a couple of seconds, and then our plan is to relax a little bit. We brought some instruments with us and want to make some mantra meditation, a couple of minutes, so just to get into the mood. And then, after that, we would like to hear from you. What is, maybe you can also once again say your name, where are you coming from, and what would be very interesting, what comes immediately into your mind when hearing the term Hinduism? Some words or something that fascinates you, something that confuses you or irritates you, something you have seen or heard. And we would like to make a little list of what could be interesting. And after that, we give a short overview, the main important data and facts about Hinduism. And then we can pick maybe one or two topics and go a little deeper. Because my experience is Hinduism is a really a vast thing, and you could cover thousands of topics in 1 hour, and at the end there is not so much left because it's just too much. Therefore I thought that we take one topic, maybe two, and we go deeper inside. And at the end, we again want to play something for you. Okay. So, about us. So my name is Param Shreyadas. I have some pencils with me. Whiteboard marker, communication. So my name is, I have a Sanskrit name, I have also a German name. Team since 27 years. We are doing things together. So,
Shiva.
His name is Shiva Atmanas. Maybe you have heard about Shiva. And maybe you have heard about Mahatma, Mahatma Gandhi. So this is a little Shiva Atmanas. Little bit similar. And you may wonder, what are these words or these names? So actually we are initiated in an old Hinduistic tradition since many, many years. And like when you are becoming a Catholic nun or like the Pope, he changed his name, as you know. So we have similar things when we have a so-called initiation. We adopt a new spiritual name, but we also keep our old names. Obviously, when I have to show my passport. So, these names here are actually names of God. Param Shreya means something like the supreme blessing. God is the supreme blessing, or can give the supreme blessing. And Shivatma is the soul of the auspicious one. Yeah. So in this Dasa is also interesting. That means servants or servant. So we don't go around and give us names of God, but we give us names of the servant of God. That is the idea. We try to feel to be a servant. Not only of God, but of all his parts also. Okay. So, I was born in 1972, and I started with 16, 17 years. I started to investigate about different religions, and for me it was not so much a question that there is one right religion and the other ones are wrong. For me that was clear from the very beginning, I would say. So. But more that there are many ways, like I have told you already, we have many ways, for instance, to go to Stockholm. We can go by plane, we can also go by boat or use different streets or paths. So some like to go by plane, some like to go by boat, or some like to go by car or bus or whatever. So, in the same way, the Hinduistic idea is that we are all individual. There is not one person who is exactly similar to another. And we have different tastes, and we have, we also have different grades of awareness or consciousness. Some people are, for instance, very aware about their environment. They treat the environment very carefully. And there are other people who just throw the rubbish left and right. So the Hinduistic idea is that you should pick up everyone where he stands. So if some person is on a very high spiritual level, you can pick him up there. But other people may be not so high. But then it is not a question that for them the game is over. No. And there are ways that they can somehow become also uplifted. So, so I investigated many different paths and religions and spiritual concepts. So, for me that was very interesting. And still now I don't think that other religions are wrong. So I try to see, what is the goal of all the religions. So, a few words. What I do in my other times, maybe you might wonder. So I'm practicing the spiritual path, but I'm also in real life. I'm a teacher for extra lessons in two schools, and I am working with 8, 9, 10 year old children a lot. So I'm also in the society. With one foot I'm in the real society, and with the other one I also practice the spiritual path of our tradition. And Shivatma das, möchte vielleicht ein paar Worte würde ich sagen. Yeah. So Shivatma das, he is practicing the spiritual path when I was born, practically. So since 1972, he's born in 1953. And he comes from another generation. You have heard about maybe the hippies and the counterculture. And, you know, liberation. And so somehow we met us in the year, I think, 1990 or so. We met us for the first time. And somehow, you know, this is also one big topic. We are strongly convinced that we are actually spiritual beings in a physical, temporary body. That means sometimes our relationships are more bodily based, but better is if our relationships are on the level of the soul, so we can have much deeper relationships. These relationships are not dependent on the body. So often relationships nowadays, they are very, you know, superficial. Something you, for instance, a man loves a woman, then it, or vice versa. At one day the man thinks, oh, I don't like her nose anymore, so, and then the relationship is over. It's a little bit drastic example, but you know, I think you get the point. So the more our relationship goes on a spiritual level, then we can go through this superficiality. Yes, and Shivatma Das, he is also in the society. He works with disabled teenagers for many, many years. And so he lives in celibacy for more than 40 years. Yes, and if you are more interested, you can also ask us questions anytime or after our official session. Yeah, that's also an idea that when we want to go into one topic, we want to have your questions or your thoughts, opinions. Okay. So we want to start with an auspicious mantra. You have seen on the door, there is this paper or this sign, and it is often used to give Hinduism a, you know, a symbol. And actually, it's the symbol you saw on the window. They are three letters, just three letters from the Sanskrit alphabet. I give you a short explanation. This is the Sanskrit A, looks like a 3, and this is a U, and then we have this dot here, this is an M. So in Latin letters it would be A, U, M. And in a sense this becomes an Om. Maybe you have heard about the Om. So Aum, it's technically Aum, a very deep sound. The Bhagavad Gita, this is, I also brought a copy of it. This is the most famous book of Hinduism. It was read, for instance, by Mahatma Gandhi every day and other persons. So in the Bhagavad Gita, it is described that Om is like the original sound. And it's interesting, many scientists of languages, the linguists, they say that the word Amen in the Biblic, in the Christian, and also in the Jewish and Islam tradition, Amen comes from Om. So just something to think about. So we want to chant a mantra called Om Namo Bhagavate. Vasudeva is also the name of God. And it means something like we offer our respect to God. So, we would like to hear from you a little bit, and maybe each of you can once again say your name, because I have forgotten some of your names already. Say where he is or she is coming from, and that famous question, what comes into your mind when you hear the term Hinduism? And we start with Mr.
Urban.
Urban.
I'm from Sweden. Hinduism. Well, I must confess I feel a bit confused now, but I think of India.
Okay.
And But at the same time, I think maybe I'm totally wrong here.
That's an answer. You feel confused by this, by hearing the term Hinduism and India.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I think of India.
Okay.
I do. Yeah.
Good.
Yeah, I'm Mr. Eric. I'm from Sweden, the same as Burma. Yeah, no, I also are a bit confused about Hinduism, but I think about balance.
Balance, okay.
Balance.
Oh, interesting.
That's the word. Balance between just like you explained, your spirit and your physical body, and like having a balance there, a balance between people, and like, and also India.
Mm.
Think about India.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
I'm Italian, and I came from Poland. I think about karma.
Okay.
It's in Hinduism. And elephant.
Yes.
So, India, balance, elephants. Karma. Something more?
No. I'm Ola. I'm from Poland too. And I think about India first. And I think that your song meditation, this mantra is really interesting and really relaxing.
Okay, so mantra meditation. Thank you.
My name is Tamara, I'm from Sweden. And I think also about meditation and reincarnation.
Reincarnation. Reincarnation. Lotus flower.
Yeah, and just gods, the many gods.
Lotus flower. And many gods. Okay.
I'm Alina, I'm from Germany, and I think of, for example, calmness itself. And
about what?
So staying calm, calmness.
Okay.
And animals as symbols.
Animals as symbols. So calmness. And animals as symbols.
For example, cows.
Oh. Okay. Holy cows.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
My name is Christos, I'm from Latvia. This makes me think of monks and inner peace.
Okay. Monks and inner peace. Inner peace. And monks. Okay. Thank you. Should we give Christophs a little bit more space?
I'm Emanuela. I come from Bosnia. And you already said a lot of things that I had on my mind, but mostly when I think of Hinduism, I think of many gods. Meditation and balance.
Okay. Good. So,
Well, that is already written.
Good.
Hey. My name is Alex. I'm from Hanover. And I mostly think of India and meditation, like, for Hinduism.
Okay.
I'm Matthew from Czech Republic, and I think of peaceful people and kind people, which meditate a lot. And
peaceful people. Peaceful and kind people. That's a very flattering.
Mm.
Thank you. Yes. Okay. We have a good list here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I would think that we give a short overview, some, you know, data, some facts that might be interesting regarding Hinduism, and then we pick one of these interesting points and let's see where the discussion is leading us. Maybe some of you have wondered how this term Hinduism is how it has come into existence, and it's quite interesting. We have that word Hindu, and what is remarkable is that in all the Hindu textbooks, like I have mentioned, this Bhagavad Gita here, and there are many other books, nowhere you find this word, nowhere, it's never appearing anywhere. So what is about this word? So you know, India looks a little bit like a triangle, like this, and here is Sri Lanka, and here is the river. I have a blue one for the rivers. Here's the river. Here's also a very famous river nobody has mentioned. You know this river? It's the river Ganges.
Mm.
So then, here is a river called Sindhu, and today that river is called Indus. And originally, in the old Sanskrit language, that river was the river Sindhu. So the Persians who lived here and sometimes tried to invade India, like you have heard about Alexander the Great, he with his troops he could invade a part of India, and the Persians, they had a problem pronouncing the S, and instead they use an H, so it became Hindu. And then the Greek became Hindu. And then the Greek who lived here, they had a problem pronouncing the word H, and they just skipped it. Like, you know, for instance, I think the Italians, they can also not are not so enthusiastic about starting ages. I had one Italian friend in my school, like from Hamburg, and he always said Amburu. So the H was missing. Yeah, and that. So in this way, we have that word Indus. And from Indus, everything what was on the eastern side of that river, they call it India. And everything what goes on here was called Hinduism. So of course, suppose we have that river Rhine here in Germany. Suppose you would go to the Rhine and say everything what is western, on the western side of the Rhine, is a religion. Let's call it Rhineism or something. So you can try that, and you will see that there's a lot of protest. What? No. We have Catholic religion here, like in Cologne. Cologne is a very Catholic city. We have also Protestant people west on the western side of the Rhine. We have Buddhists, we have Jehovah Witnesses, we have Muslims, and even a couple of guys like us. So it is a group of many concepts and religions. And this also is here in India since many thousands of years. There is not actually one religion you can call Hinduism. It's very, very difficult. Because, as I have said, in the Hindu scriptures, it is considered that we are all on different levels of consciousness, of spiritual understandings, and also of desires. Some people, they approach God, but more with an attitude to get something from God. And then there are other people who approach God, but more, you know, because they are so fascinated, and they like to think about God and feel connected with Him, just to give you an idea. So, therefore, as one of you already mentioned, there are in Hinduism many gods mentioned. Like maybe you have seen the elephant god. This is a god with a, what is it called? A trunk.
Probably.
Elephant head and a human body. Looks pretty cute. And it's very, very popular in India.
Is it called Ganesha?
It is called Ganesha, thank you. And we have others very famous like Shiva and Brahma. Maybe you have heard about Brahma. So you might ask, is there a supreme god? That's a very interesting question. Even the Hindus are discussing it since time immemorial. And the answer, when consulting the Vedic textbooks, is yes, there is one supreme one. I mentioned the Vedic textbooks. This is also interesting. We have texts in India. They are called the Vedas. Veda. This is also a Sanskrit word and means wisdom or knowledge. Yeah. And what is interesting, the language of India, the Sanskrit language, and most of European languages, they have a very strong connection. And so you find many similarities, like in Swedish, the word for knowledge is also very similar, I have heard. You are from Sweden?
Vetskap. Vetskap.
And it is
knowledge.
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
It is also starting with an
V. E.
And then
T.
And now E. T.
T. S. K-A-P. Yeah.
You have this
like science
circle?
No, no.
This is Danish, right?
No.
Okay. So you see here a very obvious similarity, and you have it also in English, for instance, a wit or a witness, or in German wissen.
Excuse me, we have that word veta. Mm-hmm. Veta, it's almost exactly the same.
To know.
It's just the T instead of the D. So, yeah, it's very similar. It's
very interesting. So, Sweden is so far away from India, but you can still see those strong connections. Yes, so Vedas are very old scriptures composed by wise men. And originally, these texts are coming from the spiritual world, it is said. Okay, we can maybe talk about that later. So,
the Supreme God.
The Supreme God, yeah. Yes, there is a huge discussion in Hinduism, who is the Supreme God? And there was one great sage, his name was Parashara Muni. And he said that the Supreme God must be a being who has six opulences in unlimited extensions. And he mentions them in a scripture, and it is called Aishwaryasya Samagrasya Viryasya Yashasashriya Jnana Vairagya Yashchaiva Shanambhaga Itingana. So in this verse, six opulences are mentioned by the sage. We actually all have something of them. So the first opulence of a person is Aishwarya, that means wealth. Someone who is very wealthy. So wealth. The second one, Aishwarya Samarasya Virya, is prowess or power. The third one, is fame. Fame. The fourth one is beauty. The fifth one is knowledge or wisdom. And the sixth one, it's also quite interesting, is vairagya, or detachment, we can translate it. Detachment. So, what is interesting is, all these six qualities or opulences makes a person attractive, isn't it? Don't we feel attracted to someone who's very wealthy? Suppose Bill Gates comes into this room. We immediately think, I want to have breakfast with him tomorrow morning. Isn't it? I'm honest, I would have this in mind, to have a breakfast with Bill Gates.
The second one, power, a person who is very powerful is attractive. Who is very powerful? Let's say Donald Trump is coming. We may have our opinions about him. But just the fact that he's very powerful makes him somewhat attractive. We talk so much about Donald Trump. When you switch on the television, the chance is 70% that something is going on about Donald Trump. People may have their opinions, but just because he's so powerful, people feel attracted to him. The camera goes to Donald Trump when he comes into the room. Then the third one, persons who are very famous are attractive. Suppose Brad Pitt is coming into this room. We also want to have breakfast with him, of course, because he's very famous. Who is honest? Who would like to have breakfast with Brad Pitt? So, beautiful. I don't have to say much about this. We feel very attracted to a person who is very beautiful. This is, you know, this is almost like automatic. Suppose the door opens and, I don't know, Miss Universe or Mr. Universe comes in. It's not a question of intellectual adjusting. We look at this person, isn't it? So, beauty is the fourth quality. The fifth one is knowledge. A person who is very, very wise, very knowledgeable, very learned, he is invited to all the political talk shows. Often there is one expert, he's invited. Or if there is a teacher in school who is really knowledgeable, we can ask him all kinds of questions. I don't know if you belongs to this. But you get the point. We feel attracted to a person who really has questions to all the answers. And the sixth one is also very interesting. Detachment. Suppose a person has all these qualities here, the first five qualities, to a big amount. Wealth, power, fame, beauty, and knowledge. But he or she doesn't become proud of it. She or he is still humble and doesn't think I'm better than others. Actually, such a person even might think, because I have all these qualities, my duty is to serve the others by my means that I have. So that is also called detachment, that someone is not becoming arrogant. So what these Vedic sages did in their discussion is, they evaluated who of all these gods, who of you has mentioned the many gods? Yeah. Who of all these gods we know in Hinduism has all these qualities in an unlimited way? And then they concluded this person must be the Supreme God.
I'm just thinking of Brahma, because that's what we were taught in school. I don't know if that's wrong, but
Okay. Yeah. In Hinduism, there's mainly talked about three principal gods. The first one is Brahma. The second one is Vishnu. And the third one is Shiva. This you will quickly come across when dealing with Hinduism. Brahma, the god Brahma, the god Vishnu, and the god Shiva. So, it is said that Brahma has created the universe. He is the creator. Lord Vishnu is the maintainer of the universe. Maintainer? No. Is it correct? I don't know.
I think so.
And Shiva is the destroyer of the universe. Yes? So, Rama, he's creating this universe. We all know that creating something is difficult. For instance, building this beautiful monastery. I think a lot of sweat and blood was shed to build this monastery. It takes maybe a couple of years. To destroy all these buildings would take a couple of days. So to create something is much more difficult or hard than to destroy something. And now comes the point. To maintain something is actually the hardest. Isn't it? Like, for instance, in a relationship between man and woman, we have to take some endeavor. Let's say a man wants to be engaged with a woman, he has to take some endeavor to establish this relationship. He has to buy her flowers and invite her to the restaurant. I don't know what they do nowadays, because I'm a monk. So it takes maybe some weeks endeavor to destroy a relationship. It maybe one word is sufficient to destroy a long-term relationship. But I think you all agree with me. To maintain a relationship, that's the real job. Yeah. We hear so often, sometimes I'm on Facebook and I sometimes watch these notification. I'm engaged, I don't know, in your language. And so often this is changing. Again and again, well, it is complicated. So I only know a few persons who really can maintain 5 or 10 or 20 years a relationship, and you become and your develops a feeling you think this is awesome. How is this possible? So again, to come back to this description, we see that Vishnu is actually the most powerful of these three gods. He can maintain a universe for a very, very long time. And actually, it is said in the Bhagavad Gita that Brahma and Shiva, they were created actually by Vishnu. And Vishnu is just taking the role of maintaining. Actually, he has created Brahma and he has created Shiva. But then he is playing the role of a maintainer. This is described in the Bhagavad Gita.
The Supreme God, was it Vishnu?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. I'm a bit tired. Thank you.
Is he also maintaining balance between the destroyer and the creator?
Right. Yeah.
Can you say that?
Very good point. Yes. Yes. Yeah, Vishnu is actually, if you are connected with God, you are more in balance. When you are connected with the Creator, it's interesting. I have brought something for you. I've brought for you three colors. Yellow, red. It's not the referee calls, you know, for the FIFA World Cup, and blue. And going back to these three main gods, there is a science described in this book, Bhagavad Gita, in the 14th, 17th, and 18th chapter. This book has altogether 18th chapter. And there is a science explained in the Bhagavad Gita about the so-called three gunas. And these gunas are forces or influences that constantly are pulling us, consciously or unconsciously. And I will explain that a little bit. The first energy we are always, sometimes less and or more, influenced by is the so-called mode of goodness. Goodness. In Sanskrit, that is called sattva. Sattva. Sattva guna. Guna means this force. This is the yellow one, to give it a color. The second one is called the mode of passion. Passion, in Sanskrit, raja or rajo guna. And we give that the color red. And the third one is called ignorance. Ignorance. And in Sanskrit, it is called tamo guna. Tamo guna. So, I will list a few qualities of that goodness energy, and maybe you will recognize yourself in these qualities. A person who is very much influenced by the energy of goodness, he likes cleanliness, he likes knowledge, light. He likes when everything is tidy. He likes discipline. good moral, he is optimistic but also realistic. He is responsible. He likes to share things with others. He likes to keep things in balance. He is not so much into the bodily consciousness, as I have explained previously. He's more on the level seeing the spiritual energy in all souls, in all living entities. Yeah? And he loves, you know, the nature. He loves, for instance, classical music, which is uplifting oneself, and so on. He is trying to avoid any kind of violence or harm for other living beings. That means, for instance, he is inclined to a vegetarian diet because he doesn't like to give other living entities harm. That is the Sattva Guna, the first energy. All living entities are to some degree influenced by this goodness. The second one, called passion or Rajaguna, I give you a few terms and maybe you recognize yourself within those words. A person who is influenced by Rajaguna, he is always dissatisfied. It is not really right. It should be the other way. He has thousands of desires. He is not satisfied. Could be always higher, faster, bigger, whatever. A person who is influenced by Rajaguna, he or she is more looking for the quantity than the quality. He or she is more not so much inclined to share things, but to take things for himself or herself. So he doesn't see the equality in all living entities, but more the difference. Like, for instance, when someone comes in, he looks very much to the body and compares the bodies. Whereas a person in the mode of goodness or Sattva Guna, he sees another spiritual soul in a body. So he puts more focus on the spiritual soul than to the temporary body. Yes, so there are a couple of other qualities. And very, you know, you need passion to create something, isn't it? If we want to start something, there we have to have this kind of energy in us called passion or Rajaguna. Yes, I want to run this marathon in 2018. And then we start working hard. So there's always hard labor included. Or maybe you want to have a better degree in some of your, what it is called, mathematics, Swedish, German, I don't know, subjects, yeah. So then we have to take up this big endeavor. So the third quality or guna or energy is called tamoguna. It's the blue card, and maybe you will recognize yourself. I do sometimes. A person who is influenced by tamoguna, he is irresponsible, for instance. He likes the night, the darkness. He likes it when everything is dirty or untidy. He is inclined to sleep a lot. He likes to take drugs, to be intoxicated, that reality is somehow twisted. He is envious of others when others have more. He is envious, he wants to destroy them. He's very destructive. He is passive, what is the word, gleichgültig, was heißt gleichgültig auf Englisch? He is, anyway, whatever. He's always, if you ask him something, he is, whatever, I have no opinion. And so on. And he's also, when his diet, looking at his diet, it is very much food where harm is included. So other creatures, they suffered a lot. So these three qualities are constantly influencing all the living entities in this universe. You see it in the human society. When you think about your friends, you will see that some of your friends, they are more influenced by this mode of goodness. Some of your friends are more influenced by this mode of passion. And some of them are more influenced by ignorance. So, Brahma, he is in charge of the mode of passion. Therefore, he can create. He has this ability to create. Vishnu, he is in charge. Who of you can guess for what quality Vishnu is in charge? Raise your hands.
Goodness.
Yeah, exactly. And Shiva.
And nothing.
Mm-hmm. And Shiva, who destroys the universe at the end, he is obviously also in charge of this ignorance energy. And just to let you know, to pacify you, after the universe is destroyed, it will be created again. It's also interesting. In the Hinduistic concept, time is not like in the Western sense, like a linear. Is this English? Linear? You know what I mean. It starts at one point and then it goes into one direction eternally. The Hinduistic idea of time is like a circle. Therefore, you have seen the Buddhist sign. This is this wheel. Actually, Buddhism has arisen from Hinduism. They are very much connected, Buddhism and Hinduism. So, time is a circle. Everything comes back. Isn't it? Don't we have always experience of the circle? Like, for instance, the four seasons. After winter, spring again starts. When we breath out, suddenly we again breathe in. So, and in the same way, to come back to our list, we have this term reincarnation. This is also a big feature of Hinduism, that when our life in this body is over, that's not the end of the story, but it is said that the soul, which is situated in the heart, according to the Bhagavad Gita, is traveling to another body and takes birth again. According to our desires and to our karma, these two factors are destinating in which type of body
we take birth again. So you see, the cycle is very interesting in Hinduism, which we don't find so much in the other religions. Something else.
Everything you read in that book, you believe everything it says without questioning it.
Okay, good question. Mm-hmm. That I am not so inclined to accept everything but blindly. Otherwise, I would immediately say yes. So, as I have previously told you, I have investigated many different religions and Ihre Frage ist, ob wir alles blind aus den Schriften akzeptieren oder auch Sachen in Frage stellen.
Man kann nur was akzeptieren, wenn man es verwirklicht hat. Also nicht über den Kopf, über das Intellekt, über die Analyse, das ist nicht möglich. Das Wissen ist in der Bhagavad Gita in seiner Gesamtheit vollkommen. Und das kann man verwirklichen durch Mantra-Meditation. Ne? Und indem man in der Erscheinungsweise der Tugend lebt, also das, was du jetzt gehört hast, ne? Dann offenbart sich das Wissen als Selbstverwirklichung. Und wenn man diese Selbstverwirklichung noch beschäftigt im Hingebungsraum Dienst, dann kann man sein eigenes Selbst, sein eigenes Bewusstsein Atma erfahren.
Super. So, Shivatma, he gives a very good answer to your question. That the Vedic process of this religion is you get some information and then you try it. And then when you feel a kind of realization, then for you it's reality and you accept it. To give an example, if you are very hungry and someone offers you a good meal, and you eat it, and you become satisfied. You don't have to think about, am I really satisfied now? No, we know it. We have eaten a good meal, and our hunger is gone. And what Shivatma said is also confirmed in one verse of the Bhagavad Gita. The Bhagavad Gita has 700 verses and it's in the 9th chapter. I think I will read it for you in Sanskrit to give you an idea about how it sounds. It's the second verse of the 9th chapter and in Sanskrit it is Rajavitya Rajavuhyam Pavitram Idamuttamam Pratyaksha Vagamam Dharmyam Susukkam Katum Avyayam. And the translation goes, this knowledge is the king of education, the most secret of all secrets. It is the purest knowledge, and because it gives direct perception of the self by realization, it is the perfection of religion. It is everlasting and it is joyfully performed. So, for instance, we had this mantra meditation. You do this every day. And by that mantra meditation, one can have a realization that actually I am not this physical body. I am an eternal spiritual soul connected to the Supreme Soul, God. You can have this realization by trying it, by practicing it. And the other interesting part in that verse is that it should be joyfully performed. It's quite interesting because sometimes we think religion, we think about, oh, I have to go to the church again, or I have to fast, or I have to sleep on a nail bed. I don't know if you are doing these things. But the Bhagavad Gita, or Krishna, who is the speaker of the Bhagavad Gita, he says that religion should be performed joyfully, with happiness. If religion is always performed in a sad way or in a destructive way, we always curse others. You know, all kinds of destructive ideas some people have while performing their religion, then something is obviously wrong. So, to answer your question again, by trying it out, you can have some experience and some realization, and then you can decide, is this real? Like this example with the hunger, is my hunger really gone? Or is it still there? So, the answer is, we have to practice it, or we have to try it out. And that's also a very important message we want to deliver to you, is we don't want to make some advertisement here for our religion. This is not our purpose. What we want is, if you already have your religion, maybe some of you are practicing Catholic, we are Catholics, or we are Protestants, or whatever, you should remain in that, on your path, if you like, and we just want to encourage you to become more spiritual in whatever religion you are. Or if you are, let's say you are an agnostic, you know, you all know what an agnostic is? Yeah. Someone doesn't know? Please be honest. Okay? Thank you. An agnostic is someone who is not sure yet if he wants to be a spiritual or religious person or not, if there is a God or not. But he's not an atheist. An atheist is someone, you know, we can also call him anti-theist, is a more stronger word. Anti-theist is one who principally rejects the possibility that there is a God. He is called an atheist, an anti-theist. But an agnostic is someone who, like, the store is still open for us. And we have a door open to the spiritual way. Yeah? So this is our message, or our request to you to become more spiritual and make your own experiences within your religion. So, yeah, and to round this up, we can sing something. And we would like to request you, if you like, to join us this time.
and see if it works for you. Actually, the chanting, in English we say chanting, which means, you know, praising the names of God, you find in all five main religions. For instance, in Judaism, King Solomon, he has built a temple. You have read it in the Old Testament. And interestingly, the temple was not called the Temple of God, but it was called the Temple of the Name of God. Yeah. So, and also in Christianity, we know Vater unser im Himmel, geheiligt werde dein Name. You know, our Father, in English you can recite it in English, or in Swedish.
Our Father in heaven, praise be your name. It's supposed to be,
I think, hallowed be thy name.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah. So you have it in Christianity, praising God's name. You have it in Judaism, you have it in Christianity, you have it also in Islam. In Islam, in the Quran, there are 99 names of Allah mentioned. And you see sometimes Islam people, for instance, the Sufis, you might have heard about the Sufis. This is a tradition within Islam. They dance a lot in circles, and they sing some names of Allah, La ilaha illallah, and they become very joyful. I personally like this tradition of Islam. So, and also in Hinduism, we have this request or this recommendation that by praising the names of God, you will become connected with God, because the name of God is not different from God himself. So we have a very famous mantra for you. Maybe you have heard it. This is the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. I will write it down for you. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Krishna, Krishna, Hare, Hare. And then, Hare, Rama, Hare, Rama. This A is long, therefore there is a line on top. Rama, Rama, and who can by his or her logic can find out who, how it will follow now? Any idea what follows now? Yes. Very good. Yes. So this is a very famous mantra. Even the Beatles have sang it. And other I think Boy George, you have heard about Boy George. Mm. He was, in my days, he was quite popular. Okay, so we can try that. We have an interesting melody. Shivatma makes a very interesting point that in Hinduism we don't have only the male concept of God, but within God is also the female. And the names Krishna and Rama
These are names of God in his different aspects. Rama means, translated, the source of all pleasure. God is the source of all happiness and pleasure. And Krishna is also a name of God who has all these six opulences I have mentioned earlier in unlimited extent. These are the male aspect of the mantra, and the female aspect is the Hare. Comes from the name Hara and means the female energy of God. Yeah.
Diese weibliche Energie, die wir in uns drin haben, erfahren, nur über diese einfühlsame Energie ist es möglich, sich an Gott ranzunähern. Radharani, seine Geliebte, die den höchsten Stand der Liebe in einer ewigen Beziehung hat. Wenn wir sie in den verehren, in diesem Mantra, können wir auch Krishna, können wir Gott lieben, können wir zum Höchsten aufsteigen und unsere wahre Identität erfahren. Und das geht nur über die weibliche Energie. Das sehen wir auch in der materiellen Welt. Die Männer sind alle abhängig von der weiblichen Energie. Die Frau hat eine ganz besondere Shakti und die Männer zu manipulieren oder für ihre
glücklich zu machen. So Shivatma says that you can only approach God or Krishna through the female energy, through Hara. And we see this also in this material world, which is a reflection, that there is a kind of fullness when man and woman are together. It's a pair, it's a new entity, a couple. A man alone is not so interesting, a woman alone is not so interesting, but when they become a couple, then it gives a new, there is a new dimension. And in the same way, this originally comes from God. We have this male-female reality. We have this originally in the spiritual world.
Hare Hare.
Band, international.
We have a music project. If you like to check out our website, we do some hip hop, some jazz,
some rap music, German rap.
If you have maybe later questions, we have our what it is called? A card?
Yeah.
Some special card? If you have WhatsApp, if there is some urgent question, you can pass it out. What was with this? What about this elephant god or something? You cannot sleep anymore. you can call us up anytime.
Okay.
Yes, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hey Krishna,